Hello everyone, my name is Pixlriffs and welcome back to the Minecraft Survival Guide. I hope you guys are having a great day. Today I'm starting off outside of the house that we're building in Founder's Forge because I've actually decided on a door shape for it and it's kind of a large one. To be honest, this isn't really all meant to be a door, or if it is, it's meant to just kind of simulate the size of the door because, as you can tell, it's just got a standard Minecraft door in the middle of it there. But I kind of like this. I like the A-frame sort of style of this doorway. It just kind of has the entire thing rooted in the ground and stretching to almost the full height of the structure, but it still leaves me a little bit of leeway to do some cool stuff with the roof. So this is going to be the main entrance, I think, for this particular house. Now, as for the insides, obviously it is still very much a field, but we will deal with that in a future episode. I do want to show you guys something else though, because in the last episode we dealt with the slime farm. We have an active slime farm down here, and in the time that it has taken me to build that wall of the house, we have acquired some slime, my friends. The slime farm has been generating them in the background, and look at this. The bounty! We have more than 4 stacks of slime in this one, and if you look in this chest here, we're actually getting a little bit of slime in there as well. The thing about hoppers right now, I've got these 2 hoppers kind of stacked on top of each other, both facing into these chests, and normally what's supposed to happen is the items that are picked up in this hopper will kind of get sucked through into this hopper and end up in the bottom chest. But there is this kind of weird quirk of hopper timing where sometimes they will end up in the top chest because they'll just get filtered through here. I think it's when more than one item comes through at once, it tends to send one down and send one across. So yeah, we are getting a fairly decent split of slimes between those, but we're getting a decent amount. That is the best part about it. So pretty soon, with a little bit more time spent in this area, or maybe just some AFKing overnight, because I think I need to get a little bit more iron ready in the iron farm as well, we will have ourselves a huge amount of slime, and we'll be able to do some fun experiments with slime blocks in future episodes. But that's not what we're going to do today, because today, I thought we've been working real hard, we've been doing projects around the base, we've been flying out to distant lands, let's have a bit of fun. And so today, I'm actually going to go out and look for one of the more recent weapons that has been added to Minecraft, and one of the final things that we need to get to kind of complete our set of tools. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, come hell or high water, today we are finding ourselves a trident. Of course, the search for a trident should not be taken lightly. We have to deal with the drowned, and the drowned are more than a little bit dangerous. So I am actually going to take off my elytra for this episode and attach a chest plate again. For once, we are going to equip a chest plate. And it's not just for protection's sake, it's also to stop me from using my elytra so freely, because I am running out of rockets. I have 19 in here, and I have an emergency sort of backup supply in here, but I really don't have a great deal of gunpowder left. I have 5 gunpowder in here, a little bit in here for making splash potions, and that is all the gunpowder I currently own. So I could go around fighting creepers and doing a little bit of overnight grind for a little bit more gunpowder, and to be honest, I might if this gets any worse. But yeah, I feel like maybe at some point soon we're going to be making a regular mob farm, like a kind of dark room mob spawner, and maybe even a gunpowder farm at some point as well. So I'm kind of holding off on doing too much creeper grind just because I know we can make it that much simpler for ourselves in the long run. So what I'm going to do, like I said, is pop the chest plate on, take the elytra off, swap these 2 over, leave the elytra in here. We might even take a fishing rod with us as well, because who knows, we might have a chance to do a little bit of fishing whilst we're out looking for drowned. But I'm going to be fully protected. We're back on the full diamond suit. No more flying for me. In fact, why have I even brought the fireworks rockets with me? I should stash them in the ender chest as well. There we go, to the beach. Well, it's not exactly the beach, it's actually my fishing shack here in the swamp. Be careful what you wish for, I guess. So we are gonna do a little bit of swimming around here, and we are gonna find ourselves some drowned. And drowned, generally speaking, are quite difficult to find out in the ocean, because they tend to come across you rather than you coming across them. But there are definitely a few places that if it's your first time visiting, you should be able to find them. For example, if you take a look out for any ocean ruins or anything like that, not necessarily shipwrecks. Shipwrecks are not included in this, but there are these ruined underwater structures that you will find, like these, where if it's your first time visiting, the drowned are sure to inhabit because they tend to generate around these. Now, these actually have some loot of their own. If we dig down into here, you'll find a treasure chest, and right now that's not generating its loot because it has a buried treasure map nearby in much the same way that the shipwrecks do. So let me bob up to the surface and see if we can find that. In fact, I'm kind of thinking that might end up being one of the treasures that we've already searched for, but but I'll keep that on me just in case, and hopefully we'll be able to find ourselves a little bit of treasure. Aside from occupying these waterlogged residences, the drowned will spawn basically anywhere underwater if there is a low enough light level. Look, this treasure map here is actually the same as the one I just picked up. I pretty much guarantee that it's the same one that we picked up in that shipwreck over there, so chances are, yes, we have already found this one. But as far as the drowned go, like I said, they will just turn up underwater in the same conditions that mobs spawn during the night. For example, like if there is a low enough light level down here, which there usually is towards the bottom of the sea, you are likely to get yourself some drowned. It may even be worth your while just bobbing up and down on the surface of the water and just looking around you frequently to see if any drowned are rising up at you from the depths, because as long as you're in water, the drowned will be able to spot you and will track you. Obviously, that's within a certain distance. They're not going to track you from like halfway across the world, halfway across the loaded chunks even, and at a distance, like other mobs, they have a chance to despawn once you're 32 blocks or more away from them. But yeah, you'll probably find yourself a few drowned swim towards you if you're out here for a long enough time. And in the meantime, you get to explore these magnificent ravines. Now, I've seen a few requests in the comments for me to get a trident, and some people have even suggested drowning a zombie spawner and waiting for the zombies from that to convert into drowned and then killing them for the trident. And I'm sorry to tell you guys that on Java Edition, at least, it is not that simple. Drowned converted from zombies, a zombie that has been underwater for long enough to convert it into a drowned, do not spawn holding any kind of equipment, like tridents, and they don't naturally drop tridents. The only chance on Java Edition you will get to owning a trident is if you actually attack a drowned that has spawned with one. You don't tend to get them just as regular drops. If a drowned is holding a trident, it has a chance to drop a trident, but that is as close as we get to a decent chance of owning one. But so far, none of the drowns I have seen have actually been holding anything, which is kind of unfortunate. I wonder if maybe we're going to be better served to explore the ocean a little bit further and find ourselves a drowned ruin that has not yet been discovered, and that will have a better chance of spawning drowned than if we just kind of hang out in the ocean looking for them. The only problem with that is I don't have my elytra on me, so I don't really want to go too far away, because it would mean having to find my way back over a long distance, which I guess, you know, I could get a boat for or something. You know what? Yeah, that seems like a good idea. We'll take this boat out to undiscovered areas of the land, and let's see where we are in relation to this buried treasure. Have I discovered this one before? Yep, the treasure maps both lead to this spot here, which is what we actually dug up in the episode where I first looked for buried treasure. So thanks for nothing, I guess. And we are now rowing out into the vast ocean that I think also contains the Mushroom Islands, the ocean monuments that we visited, that kind of stuff. But there we go. This is a perfect example of what I mean. Down here, we have a ruin and a drowned has spawned outside, and oh gosh, the Dolphin's Grace effect always takes me by surprise when it happens. There we go. Now, do either of you guys have a trident? It doesn't look like this guy does, or his friend. Most often, when a drowned with a trident spawns, you will probably get hit with the trident long before you actually see the drowned, because they will throw them from quite a range. Oh, we got a Luck of the Sea 3 fishing rod and an emerald in this chest. Well, that's a little bit better than the treasure map that always points me to the same place. It's actually very easy to spot those underwater ruins at night because they glow. Like, they've got sea lanterns and stuff embedded in them, so they will glow at night, and you can even see them kind of from the surface during the day. That's quite how bright they end up being. But yeah, we don't seem to be running into all that many of them, I'm sorry to say. Whoa, now you're talking. We have a bunch of drowned and one with a trident. Now, unfortunately, we are not guaranteed to get the trident off of this guy, and especially not if his friend over there kills him. So how about we try and take this guy out as a priority? Now, remember, there is not an absolutely 100% chance of getting the trident off of this guy. No, don't you kill him. Don't you kill him before I get to him. Stay back. There we go. At least we took care of that guy. But like I was saying, this guy has spawned with equipment, but that does not mean we are going to get the equipment off of him. There is a very slim chance of us actually acquiring this trident. I think even with looting 3 on the sword, which is what I have right now, it's still only about an 11% chance, 11 or 12% chance that this guy will actually drop the trident he is holding. There we go. Oh no, he dropped a gold ingot, which is nice, I guess, but it is not the trident we were after. Oh well. I guess I'll have to fight my way through the rest of these guys and then keep looking, huh? There's a ton of kelp up here on the surface, and I think it may have actually generated before this underwater ruin generated, and that displaced all the kelp when it all sort of generated around here. Now let's see. Oh, we have a blast protection 2 book. Now the drowned only have a 15% chance of spawning holding a trident. So if you take that into account and then take into account the 11% chance of them actually dropping it, the odds of you getting a trident just from finding drowned out here in the wild are relatively slim. Oh, there we go. I can see in the distance that's the nether portal, and that is our ocean monument that we've already raided and dug out, which we'll be back to in future. I know a few people have asked if we're going to be making a guardian farm in this series. Of course we are. If you can do it in survival, we are probably going to be doing it in this series as a rule of thumb. But as I was saying, taking into account quite how rare it is to find a drowned with a trident, and how it's even more rare to have that drowned actually drop the trident it's holding, you can see why some people have taken to building drowned farms instead of just roaming the oceans looking for them. And that, while time consuming, can often be one of the best solutions to this problem, especially when you take into account multiplayer servers where lots of people will be wanting tridents and very few people will be getting them. I've now come out here about 2,500 blocks away from our spawn point, and I've come across a frozen ocean biome full of packed ice and snow. And I think we might actually take this opportunity to harvest a little bit of it, because I've not gotten some anywhere else in the series. We haven't been out to a packed ice spikes biome or anything like that. So this, if I've got my silk touch pick on me, will be a great opportunity to gather some of this. We're going to hop out and grab a bunch of it. And much like the stone we've been insta-mining with our beacon, ice and packed ice will just break instantly. Even if you don't have haste, you will just be able to break through those with your efficiency pickaxe. And it's kind of satisfying, actually, to gather a whole bunch of this stuff at once. But ice and packed ice are slippery, which can actually be a really useful mechanic in Minecraft. For things to retain their inertia, for you to be able to, like, throw items along and have them slide, a lot of people used to use this in item transport. And in fact, they still do. If they're taking items through water streams around a storage system or something like that, then it's actually really useful to have some packed ice around. People also use them for transport, because packed ice and boats actually go together quite well, surprisingly well. And in fact, if people want to travel long distances, you'll find people making roads out of packed ice in the Nether and simply taking a boat along one of those, and it moves super fast. I can probably give you an example if I flatten this out and just take the boat that we've been using to travel around to the top of this iceberg here. Here we go. Let's see if we can get a good demonstration of this. There we go. Whoa, we're picking up speed, and it's not the best environment to actually test this out, but believe me, it's fast. There are three types of ice. There is this regular ice, which is semi-transparent. It will melt in higher light levels, and it turns back into water when you break it, like so. There is packed ice, which you can also craft out of regular ice by combining it in a 3x3 crafting interface. And the third form is this. This is blue ice. It's crafted out of packed ice. We would turn all of that into a stack of blue ice, which I'm kind of tempted to do, but I think I might actually keep the packed ice for now. So when it comes to player and item transport, blue ice is going to be the fastest because it is the slippiest, but it's also got the problem that if you want to craft a single block of it, you need 81 blocks of ice, because you're putting 9 blocks into a single packed ice, and then you're putting 9 packed ice blocks into a single blue ice. So yeah, it's better to come out to an iceberg biome and harvest the stuff when it's naturally spawned in the wild. Also, because iceberg biomes generate these really awesome archway structures in them occasionally, which I personally think are really cool looking. But enough getting distracted by icebergs. I'm here for one thing and one thing only, and that is to find myself a trident. So I'm going to try and search down a few more of these underwater ruins, attract the attention of some more drowned, and I will be back when we are ready to get ourselves a trident. We've got another one, folks. Oh, we've got two of them. There are two trident-wielding drowned here. Well, I guess we'll have to try and take them on one at a time and hope that we don't get too badly injured in the process. Oh, gosh, it's a little bit difficult to evade these guys. You just got to bob and weave, zigzag left and right, keep them on their toes. There we go, one down, and it doesn't look like he even dropped anything aside from maybe a little bit of rotten flesh there, I guess. All right, where's our second guy? He's down there. Oh, no. No, he took damage on some magma blocks. He got pulled down by the magma blocks. That wasn't even a player kill, which means he had no chance of dropping it. Oh, that is cruel and unfair. This guy at least is holding a Nautilus shell, though, so it means he has a chance of dropping that for us. Yes, there we go. We got another Nautilus shell. Fantastic stuff. We only have 4 of those right now. We need 8 to make ourselves a conduit. So maybe if we can't get a trident in this episode for whatever reason, if I just absolutely fail to find a dram that will drop a trident for me, then maybe we can at least wrap this episode up by showing you guys what a conduit does and how to make it. Well, folks, the search continues, and I still haven't found a drowned who's going to drop a trident for me, but I have found something even better. This right here is a coral reef, and it's the first one I've found in this entire world. It has taken me a good long while. Oh, hello, there's drowned here as well, so maybe this is one of our chances. So coral reefs can be found in warm oceans throughout the world, and the reason I haven't dedicated an episode to finding one of these yet is kind of similar to the way that I haven't dedicated an episode to finding a trident yet, and it's because they are quite difficult to find. It's not possible to look up the coordinates of one of these on any kind of mapping tools other than, I think, maybe Amidst does it now. But most browser-based mapping tools don't have the different oceans mapped out yet, so it's not going to tell you where a cold ocean or a warm ocean is. And that means you can't exactly go out and find a coral reef straight away. You have to do an awful lot of searching. So this is my first time actually finding one in this world, and I'm going to take the coordinates of this because my inventory is currently full of packed ice that I want to take home, and I don't really want to throw away any of the loot and stuff that I've gotten from these underwater cities. So I'm going to take F3 coordinates of that so that I can come back here some other time, because it would be great to do an episode about coral reefs and the different types of coral. There's a bunch of different stuff we can get here, including sea pickles, which are a new lighting source in 1.13. We will definitely come back here and do a little bit more to do with coral reefs, because these are fascinating places and there's some really neat applications for building with them. Another ocean ruin, another trident wielding drowned, and apparently his son, I guess. There's a baby drown coming at me as well. Let's see if we can weave past and get this guy. Oh, did he drop anything? Nope. Looks like he didn't. Oh, that sucks. Trident thrower number 6 at this point, I think. Let's see if we can get a trident out of this guy. He's got a couple of friends hanging around with him, so I'll try and take care of them as well. But my main focus is going to be this one. Still, nope, still just rotten flesh. Oh, sad times. Well, still no sign of a trident just yet, but this is going to be our 4th Nautilus shell, which means we have a total of 8 now, including the 4 that I got from fishing, and that means that at the very least, if we don't find a trident, we can make a conduit in today's episode, and I'll introduce conduits to you guys. By the way, it is worth diving down into these buildings where you can, because sometimes drowned will actually get stuck on the inside of here. The place will generate in a way that doesn't allow them to get out, or maybe they get stuck on a block like that guy did, and so occasionally you will find some drowned in here that just don't get out ever. This is the 2nd guy who came at me with a trident from these ruins. The 1st guy sadly did not drop one. Let's see if this one does any better. And I don't know if I'll have enough inventory space to actually... Oh, yes! Yes, we got one! Oh, I'm so happy! Oh my gosh. Okay, so full disclosure, this has taken me about 2 hours worth of playing. This has been quite the experience. But let me tell you, when it comes to collecting tridents in Minecraft, there is the hard way, and then there is the other hard way. There really is no easy way to do this in Java Minecraft, unless you feel like building an enormous drowned farm is easy. But I'm so happy we got ourselves a trident. And not only that, but it is a completely unenchanted trident, which means we can kind of have the full run of the whole like set of enchantments that is possible to put on a trident. Oh! Oh, I'm happy now. Oh, it means I can actually put out this episode for a start. But yes, fantastic stuff. Let's see where we were when we got that. 2,000 blocks. Yeah, that's we've been traveling quite a lot. I've been scouring all of these ruins to see if anybody will give me a trident, and it's taken so long. Like, I have lost count of the amount of attempts there have been to get ourselves a trident in this episode, but we have one now, so I can head back to base. We can take a look at enchanting this, and oh boy, we're gonna have some fun. So after all that, here we are back at the base, safe and sound, with a trident and a few Nautilus shells to our name as well. Now, where did I put the others of those? There we go. Brilliant. So we have ourselves enough Nautilus shells to make a conduit, but thanks to the finally having actually got a trident in this episode, we're not gonna go into conduits this episode. We'll probably save that for another time. But in the meantime, we have a few choices to make regarding this trident. Now, I do want to put, let's say, mending and unbreaking on this as a standard kind of thing, right? Because if we're going to be doing anything with this, the thing about tridents, much like other tools, they have durability and they will break permanently. So it's not like Elytra where they end up as a broken version of that item in your inventory. If you throw a trident, you throw it away. Basically, it is gone for good. And tridents can be thrown in much the same way as you can fire a bow. You just kind of hold down the right mouse button and then you have to pick it up at a distance. So there are a couple of different options for that, because there are two different kind of conflicting enchantments that you can put on a trident. The first of which is loyalty, which will actually recall the trident when it's thrown. So anytime you throw the trident away, it kind of comes back to you after it's hit whatever you're targeting. This can actually be an incredibly useful enchantment, because right now I threw the trident further up in the wall and it's actually stuck there. I have to pillar up so I can get it back down. So obviously having a trident return to you automatically is going to be a good idea. The other enchantment we could potentially put on a trident is Riptide. And Riptide has a very special ability where if you're in water or if it's raining and you throw the trident, instead of throwing the trident, you basically throw yourself. The trident propels you up into the air, almost like you've just taken off with Elytra. And in fact, if you don't have Elytra on and you don't have feather falling on your boots, it can throw you high enough up in the air that the fall damage will kill you. So you've got to be very, very careful about how you use that. However, that would solve our fireworks problem, because we would never really need to have fireworks on us to get into the air as long as there was some water around. And I carry a bucket of water on me basically all the time anyway, so I could basically take off from wherever I wanted to. At that point, I would probably still use fireworks to propel myself wherever I needed to go, but having a Riptide Trident is a good thing. However, that eliminates the possibility of you throwing the Trident at something, which means that loyalty and another enchantment called Channeling, which we will get into much later, is kind of obsolete and doesn't work the same way. So therefore, those enchantments aren't compatible and you can't have both of them on a trident at the same time. So what I would like to ask you guys is, what should I do? Should I put loyalty and maybe channeling on this trident so that I can throw it as an offensive weapon? Or should I put Riptide on it so I can use it for a more utilitarian thing of throwing myself into the air using Riptide and traveling around with that? I will leave that up to you guys to decide. In fact, I'm going to put a poll in this video to choose which enchantment you think I should put on this. Loyalty and channeling or Riptide? Let me know. But in the meantime, let's talk a little bit about how useful the trident actually is, and the reason that I haven't got one earlier in this series. I haven't been scouring the oceans looking for drowned. The thing about tridents is they're okay as a melee weapon. They're not too bad. You can poke them with a fork just the same way you can poke them with a sword or an axe, and in fact, it has basically the same attack damage value as a diamond axe. So that's pretty good. A diamond sword has about 7 attack damage. Mine has 10 because it's got sharpness, but that sharpness 5. So that does kind of increase a fair bit. However, you can't put sharpness on a trident. The only enchantment that actually increases the damage a trident does is called Impaling. And here's the kicker. Impaling only works on underwater mobs. And weirdly enough, that does not include the drowned, because the drowned technically count as undead mobs, and so they don't have the classification of being underwater mobs, even though they are only ever found underwater. So the only thing that the trident is actually good for when it comes to actually fighting stuff underwater is guardians. And we've already raided an ocean temple, and we're in the process at some point in the future of converting it into a guardian farm, which will mean we probably never have to actually fight a guardian again. So that's the question, really. Like, do we want to use the trident as an offensive weapon in the first place? The answer is probably no, because my diamond sword is probably going to be fine. I have a ranged weapon in the form of my bow, which is actually really, really great. And when it comes to throwing tridents around, it doesn't really have a huge amount of durability, and I honestly don't think it's going to be worthwhile, especially when 1.14 comes around and we get crossbows, because crossbows are going to be amazing. So it really does come down to whether or not we want to put loyalty and channeling on this thing and just have it as something that is fun to throw around, or if we want to put Riptide on it and have that in tandem with our Elytra being a really great way of traveling around the world. Let me know, and that is going to be it for this episode of the Minecraft Survival Guide. Thank you so much for watching. My name has been Pixlriffs. Don't forget to leave a like on this episode if you enjoyed it. Subscribe if you want to see more, and I will see you guys soon. Take care. Bye for now.